Shabbat Shalom. So it's really a thrill to have our speakers tonight, but I want to just especially say how delighted I am to have Dan Ehrenkrantz here. So many of you, though not all of you, know that he was the rabbi at B'nai Keshet before me. And when I first applied for this job, he told me that he had been, I mean, and it was a fact, that he had been a rabbi here for 13 years. And I thought, wow, that's a long, long time. So that was 20 years ago. I had Dan as a teacher when I was in a rabbinical school, and I'll just say that he was a great teacher. And if you had him as a rabbi, you know that that is true. And it's part of what made me excited to be here, but it's also part of what made me afraid to be here, to know that I would be trying to walk in his footsteps. And luckily for me, the fact that I was the rabbi after Dan meant that I got to be at a congregation that was used to having a really good rabbi, and that therefore was a really solid congregation. Many of you know that he went on to be the president of the rabbinical college, and he has served the movement in so many ways. And in addition to that, he continues to do all kinds of important consulting work around the country and beyond. And so when we heard that he had a new book, like 8 people emailed me on the same day to say, when is he coming to B'nai Keshet? So, and we were really glad that we're, I don't know, one of the first places to get to have you speak about your book. Newer to our community is Jay Michaelson. So Jay, I first met at a silence retreat. And I don't know, for 6 or 7 days, I kind of sort of knew who he was. And we spoke not at all. But, you know, as it happened, I sat across the room from him and could often, if I happened to open up my eyes during meditation, look over and see him, you know, hanging out probably in like a Baha hoodie or something like that. Jay also has been a really inspirational teacher. If you read any Jewish publications, you are bound to have read his teachings, his thoughts, his commentaries. For me, some of the teaching that he's done and writing that he's done that's been most powerful for me has been on the idea of non-duality in God. And it's been part of giving words to my own experience of the divine. And for that, I'm very grateful. And I'm also delighted that when he moved to town and I said, we should have lunch, he was just like, oh, yes. And then afterwards, he was like, I'm always available for lunch. And made himself immediately available and said, I would love to be able to, you know, do something. So what might we do? And as it happened, he'd already read Rabbi Dan Ehrenkrantz's book and mentioned the idea that maybe there's some way we could do something together. So I'm really delighted that he's here tonight to ask some thoughtful questions and help bring out some of the teachings from Dan's new book. And we're going to listen to them both talk for a little while, and then we're going to open it up for questions. So welcome to you both. It's a pleasure to have you here, and I turn it over to you. Make sure both of your mics are on.
I was just going to say, how's that level? Sound good? About right?
And testing, all good?
Okay. Great. Thanks, Rabbi, and thanks. This is fun. So Rabbi Elliott just talked about non-duality, which is, in a way, the subject of the book. I would say not even in a way. I'd say it's the subject of your book. And I want to start, you know, the subtitle is a little unusual. For people who are familiar with Jewish text, Ayeka, where are you? This fundamental question that God asks of Adam in the Garden of Eden story myth. Maybe that's a little familiar, although you redefine it. I'm sure we'll talk about that. But A Beginner's Guide to Advanced Spirituality, that's the kind of subtitle that, you know, my editor wouldn't let me put on my book. And I want to suggest that it's actually really accurate. So for folks who haven't read the book, this is a weird book, right? And I mean that as a compliment. I think for a lot of folks, and me included, you know, when we hear the word spirituality, we think of things like what we just finished here, spiritual practice. Spiritual practice shifts your mood, shifts your mindset. So before we came here, I was thinking about work or my mortgage or whatever. And then we came here and I was thinking about gratitude and having uplifted thoughts, maybe closer to God if that's a concept for me, or just inspired in some way. And I would say something like 98% of spirituality is somewhere along, it kind of does that, whether it's a yoga class or a meditation session or a prayer service, a chant service. But what's in this book is different and kind of fundamentally different, I think. And part of the reason that I jumped at the chance to have this conversation is I also wrote a book about non-duality, a book called Everything is God. And there I was kind of at pains to say, spirituality is great, but this is something else or a different flavor. So I'd love, rather than me putting that in my words, for maybe that could be the first kind of question is like sort of what this book is about and how is it different from how I think almost all of us understand spirituality.
Wonderful. So first, it's really nice to be here. And so pleased to be in conversation, Jay, with you. It's a real treat for me. Spirituality is one of those words like God or love that everybody uses, and people mean very different things when they say these words. So you can often feel like you are communicating and actually talking to each other, and often you are talking really very much past each other. And there's kind of no rule book that says, you know, when you say spirituality, you have to mean this or you can't mean that. And so in the book, I go to some effort to try and define it the way that I want to define it for the purposes of the book. And I really appreciate the question because I think it gets to the heart of what is this book and what am I doing in the book, which is, yes, beginner's guide, because I find myself at that's the vantage point from which I can write this. I'm relatively new to this. This isn't like I, you know, woke up at 5 years old and they came to me and said, you're the next Dalai Lama. Like, that was not my experience. It was really going through and being a rabbi and being in lots of environments, yoga classes, meditation, in prayer, where I had these wonderful uplifted kinds of experiences and, you know, got real juiced and felt like really good. And then I would walk away. And as you said, it's like, oh, now it's the mortgage and it's the, you know, the shopping list and whatever else as soon as I would leave. And I wanted to look at that and say, well, you know, that's not really right. I want to be able to not have to jump into whatever communal singing in order to contact or have that sense that communal singing gives me. And what I recognized is that I was misidentifying, that I would have those experiences and I would say whatever it was, if it was a communal experience, you know, that was something that we all did together. That was really nice. I felt really good about it. A personal meditation experience. Oh, I achieved something in that meditation. I got to some, you know, profound deep place, and then I left it. And what I began to recognize is that the me that was having those experiences was not the same me is the me that was going home and recognizing it. The me that was having those experiences was not I'm going to say the person Dan Ehrenkrantz that I've come to know and love these many years, right? It was a part of me that that could have gone in any number of different directions, that was more the life potential living within me. And that's what happened at those times, was I was connected, isn't even the right word. I recognized that, oh, that's what's going, that's who I am. And then I would leave and I would come back to the, oh, I'm Dan, you know. Very hard to articulate. I'll say it this way. When I go home tonight, I am likely to be in my car and to say, I hope I gave a good talk. I hope that I gave something to people who came. And part of that will be me trying to wrestle with this me thing. And in a way, that is insignificant. That part of me that kind of needs to feel good that I gave something to you. And that disappears, that part disappears and is, I would say, contained within a much larger wholeness that gets into this question of non-duality. That experience of me as the separate self is an experience, it's a perception, but it is not the greatest truth of what life is, or what we could even say what my life is.
So let me unpack that.
Thanks.
That was clear, everybody got. Yeah, so what I find peculiar about this mode of spirituality, and again, we share it, so I feel I can say use words like weird and peculiar and bizarre, and yeah, is that you sort of get to disappear, right? So a lot of the metaphors that are used for non-duality and for the relationship, the Hasidim called this the small self and the expanded self. The mochin de katnut, the small ordinary mind, which sees in terms of dualities, don't cross on a red, don't run the red light, it's a green light, go. And the expanded mind in which everything is just ripples on the cosmic ocean. Ram Dass, famous spiritual teacher, had a long joke, but for time, I'll just cut to the punchline, which is that you're not a wave, you're water. Right? It looks like we're all separate waves on the ocean, but really our essence is water. Joseph Goldstein, a Jewish Buddhist teacher, says that the small self is a little bit like the Big Dipper. So you can look at the Big Dipper and it's there, but we all know there's no such thing as the Big Dipper, right? I mean, that's just a way of looking at the stars that happen to be out in the sky. And if you were to shift, go to a different solar system, you know, there would be no Big Dipper. So the small self, our conventional self, is a way of looking. That does feel different from having a nice davening, having a nice prayer experience. Where is that? So I guess the way I'll frame this question is like, well, how did you get into that? So did you go off? So you mentioned, you know, Ramana Maharshi, a great Indian sage who taught this way. The process that's in the book is known as the process of inquiry or self-inquiry. In one form of this practice, which you don't actually give over, but one form is you just keep asking, like, who am I, over and over and over. And so you go through all the usual answers in your first hour of doing it. Then you're in your second hour, and you're like, I don't know who I am. All of these things are thoughts and things that came from somewhere else and genetics and whatever, and it's contingent, and there's no real me here. And you have the line, I had to write it down. The prompt is locate the place from which thoughts arise. So locate the place from which thoughts arise. What were the practices, or how did you get into it?
By mistake. Really, it was, you know, because I was working in all these rabbinic roles, it was natural to be around God talk and spiritual talk and all that. And I think what happened, if I can trace it as best I can, is that I just got tired of me. These same stupid thoughts would come around again and again and hook me and disturb me and bother me. There are lots of them, but I'll give one, like, will I be economically secure in a way that I want to be economically secure? And I would have anxiety about this, and I would have feelings about it. And eventually it was like, you know, all these thoughts are just not changing anything. They are just a way that I am torturing myself. And it was kind of an exhaustion of looking for that something more, which is how I began my kind of spiritual search and how probably part of what brought me to want to be a rabbi. Oh God, can I find you? How can I have that intimate relationship with you? I long for you. I yearn for you. And all that longing and all that yearning got me longing and got me yearning and longing and yearning. And I just got exhausted, really. And I think what happened in the exhaustion was just kind of a... And in that, that's where stuff showed up. When I stopped trying to get somewhere and I just, I can't do this. I want to get somewhere that I can't get. And I think what kind of came back was, that's right, you can't get there. Like, you must give up because you aren't going to get there. And when I just let go of it, then that's where it opened up for me.
Was there a... I lead meditation retreats, including one in December. Was there a retreat you went on? That wasn't a leading question. It wasn't one of my retreats. But like, was there the come to Jesus moment? Like, where?
Yeah. So one of the reasons there are a number of books in this genre, and you know, I wrote this book sort of because it just came like it. What I found myself doing, really, I was writing this book. But as I was doing it, I asked myself, why the heck are you writing another book? Like, you know, of the making of many books, there is no end. And one of the things that I felt was different about kind of my articulation of this was that there wasn't that. Like, usually, and what is in the zeitgeist a lot is the retreats and meditation is real big now. And I know you work helping to help people find meditation and grow through that. And that is wonderful. That wasn't my path. I was doing yoga regularly, and I talk about that in the book, and that was absolutely a catalyst, was for me, that yoga practice, but so was the meditation that I was doing, so were other things. I didn't, because my path was less, I would say, yeah, you know, here's what you have to do to be spiritual. It's really, really hard. It's going to take you a really long time. And when you invest, you know, years and years and years going to meditation retreats, you still won't actually get there, but maybe you'll get a little closer. Like, that is the way that this is often spoken about. And I wanted to say, actually, this isn't so hard. It's not far away from you. It's pretty clear. It's not like, I don't think my book is simple. I don't know, but I tried to make it not hard and accessible. And you don't need to go to meditation retreats or, you know, go to yoga classes or be a special person. This is available to anybody pretty much at any time. What it requires is putting all of yourself in and then being able to reflect and understand those moments in a way that I didn't for many years. Again, I felt I'm very special. I'm a damn good meditator. That was a great experience. I'm so cool. And walking away and saying, wait a second, that's not the right lesson to take from those experiences. What were those experiences? Who was that had that experience? That wasn't the same me that is so proud of having been such a great meditator.
All right, so let's do the When Harry Met Sally experiment, which is I'll have what she's having. You're the she. So I want to mention that not only did we not prepare any of the questions, but Dan has absolutely no idea what I'm about to do. So we're just going to see how this flies. So live in real time, including on Zoom or wherever it is,
yep.
I want to talk to the non-seeking, non-desiring mind. So, who are you?
Hmm. What is it, a what? Is it a mind? Aware of mind, capable of understanding your question, but difficult to articulate in words an answer that would feel true and honest. Any answer would feel if it was half-baked, if it was a try, as if it was a feeble attempt.
So again, talking to the source of radiant open awareness, Tibetans call Rigpa. How does it feel over there?
At the moment, the background calm and joy. I recognize the person, Dan, who's like also a little like nervous and edgy because he's talking in front of a group. So I recognize that that's happening too. But the entity to which you are addressing your question has a calm, quiet, and kind of fun, joyful sense.
So from that, speaking again to that awareness, is it a really big problem that Dan is a little neurotic right now?
No, Dan's humorous. Right? He's kind of entertaining because he's so silly and so ridiculous. And so I'm kind of having a fun time sort of smiling and laughing at his feeble attempts.
So talking to Mohin de Gadlut, this expanded mind, I like non-seeking, non-desiring mind. It's just a nice, the via negativa, you talk about in the book, can be more helpful than saying, I'd like to talk to God within you, but same thing, but the non-seeking, non-desiring mind. So there's suffering in the world, and there's injustice, violence, there's oppression. What's the response to that?
The instant feeling when you say those words is it just evokes immediate compassion, the desire to ameliorate, to help, to somehow comfort that reality.
So last question from the small mind to the expanded mind. But it sounds like where you're hanging out, everything's perfect. So why is suffering a problem? Why do you feel compassion? Maybe it should just, it is how it is, and that's how it is.
Yes, I think this is a paradox that I really don't fully understand, honestly. Like, and I wrote that in the book. This is a paradox that has to be experienced rather than explained. Because somehow those two exist at the same moment. The way that I can, now this is kind of the small mind, like trying to articulate it. The way that I can articulate it is imagining myself kind of on my deathbed. And there's tremendous like pain and suffering and sadness for sure, but also then looking at what's there. And within that sadness, there's this beauty, this world, even the sadness, even the suffering, is somehow something beautiful that I don't want to leave behind. It's not that the sadness and the suffering is like, oh, that's good, or, oh, that's okay. It's not okay, it's not good. But somehow it is contained and beautiful despite the tragic nature of it.
Okay, neurotic Dan can come back. Yeah, Allen Ginsberg once
He'll
said
never
about,
leave.
About that paradox, that there all there is great pain and great love.
Mm. That's a nice way. That's beautiful.
I thought.
Yeah.
Great pain and great love. There's one part, so now and for my last 5 minutes before we go to everybody's Q&A, I want to do a little bit of critical, like, that's why I invited regular Dan back in. One of the challenges that I found in the book, but also in the way this is often presented, this teaching, and this is sometimes called like the direct path. Adi Ashanti, who you mentioned in the book, is a wonderful writer who teaches in this way. I will say, I think the only, as far as I know, and I think I have a lot of familiarity with this tiny little genre that only 1% of the world cares about. I think this is the first most clear Jewish giving over of this particular kind of teaching, of direct path teaching. So for those of us who are like spiritual, long in the tooth, we've done like a million of these things, it's like, oh yeah, this is the direct path. This is non-dual inquiry. This is how you jump over all of this, all of the thing where you said you go to 20 retreats and then maybe, I work for a company called 10% Happier. So you're like going for 100% happier, right? And that's what their direct path does. You know, before I do the critical thing, I have one last question on the positive side. What is enlightenment?
So again, this is one of those words that people are going to understand very differently. The way that I understand it is being able to see the world as it is, and what that means is being able to penetrate beyond the illusion of separateness. This idea that I'm over here and you're over there, and there's no sort of bridge or connection, that that enlightenment is being able to see that that's only true in a limited sense. We'll say one more thing. Some people use the word enlightenment to mean that I always see the world in that way. I always have that experience. It never leaves me, not for one second. And until I am able to abide in that enlightened perspective, I'm not enlightened. I'm kind of working towards it. And I don't mind that definition, but I prefer, because I think it's inviting, to say enlightenment doesn't need to be all the time and at every moment and abiding and never go away. It can be there in its moments. And it is not something that, again, is outside the realm of the possible for you. And so you don't need to imagine, well, I'm not an enlightened person, I'll never get there. You can say, no, and a way that I like to say, I can taste enlightenment. Maybe you can taste it a lot.
I love that. Yeah, Ram Dass again, when he was in his 40s, said, if you think you're enlightened, go spend some time with your parents. which he did, by the way, after he got back. So Ram Dass used to be Richard Alpert, big psychedelics researcher, went to India, became enlightened, came back. And in the two-year period in between coming back and becoming a famous spiritual guru to millions and millions of people, went to live with his family, which I love that, like, Ram Dass, thanks, Dick Alpert, great, you're back from India, now you're living, you know, with your dad or whatever. And it was an interesting test of what that is, what that enlightenment is, that Kabbalists call it, you know, Retzova show of running and returning. That, like the angels, you know, you're going back and forth, and you're going back and forth between expanded mind and small mind. And but I think even in the word small mind is what I was going to say before, that there is this tendency to denigrate the ego. Mm-hmm. That I did circle the parts in the book where I felt like you were doing that. But there's this tendency, it's like, oh, well, the ego sucks, right? Ego's constantly, it's like making me it's making me cruel to other people, making me cruel to myself, it's making me feel separate, it's making me dominate others, particularly those of us who identify as men, like this is making me try to do hierarchy, and it's making me, but in Chassidut and in Kabbalah, there's also an affirmation that without the Yetzer Hara, the world wouldn't exist, you know, nothing would get done. And where, can you talk a little bit about that interpenetration or Retzova Shov, or in a way that values the way most of us live our lives most of the time?
Yeah, first I want to say that I appreciate that you caught that in the book, because I think you're right. There are places where I do denigrate ego in the book, and this was something I wrestled with as I was writing it, because I think it's difficult to get through and get past ego. And a technique that I would say I used in the book was to engage in, especially in the earlier parts of the book, a bit of denigration in order to kind of help, I hope, the reader move to a different place. And then later in the book, I tried to kind of bring it back a little bit. And if I was to rewrite the book, I might be a little more articulate and transparent about that move that I was making. So I think you picked up something that was true and something that I wrestled with and that I, you know, maybe could have done better.
How does the non-seeking, non-desiring mind feel about that mess up in your book? Doesn't care.
Not surprised.
Not at all. There is Dan Danning. That's how, right?
Exactly. It's like, of course. And probably 10 years from now, I'll look at it. Oh, my God.
Well, only Dan's going to look at it like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, then you can do some practice.
Like, and, I'm so and... embarrassed to have written that thing.
Which part of you is embarrassed? The ego.
Absolutely.
See, you were right. The ego's
absolutely
a schmuck.
So in terms of the question, which is really an important question that you're asking, you know, what is this role of ego? And I will say that that's a live question for me. It's not like I got it and I feel like I've answered it. What I will say for me is that ego, it's not like it disappears. It's not that it goes away. And you know, anybody that tells you I have completely destroyed my ego, I would start to get a little distrustful. Maybe, I mean, it's possible, but I would look real close at that. And so for me, there's this dance that I feel that I am in, that mochin de gadlut, that big mind. But I'm also open to the possibility that, you know, and I could be missing a bunch of stuff here, you know, and ego is still around. It's not like ego goes, but ego is still playing its game. And ego's game is really clever and really strong. You want to know how strong it is? Like, just look at yourself and say, like, I am a separate person. And then, you know, try and get yourself out of that. And if you can get into that idea of I'm a separate person, well, then ego is, you know, doing its thing. Ego does its thing very powerfully. And so for me, rather than, I would say, you know, finding that place for ego, I'm pretty confident that ego is like...
Find its place for itself.
It's going to be around, and I try and sink into as much as I can that other kind of mind, and then just try and see how ego plays.
Yeah, I think for me... One of the modalities that's been really helpful for me just in the last couple of years has been internal family systems, which I'm sure a lot of folks in the room know about, just sort of seeing that the parts of ourselves which we tend to other or shadowize or say, that's my weakness, that's my bad side, don't see that, don't see my anger, I'm ashamed of my anger, I'm ashamed of this, that there's really no bad parts. This is Richard Schwartz, the title of his book, No Bad Parts, that these are all parts that either are serving us now in some way that we could look at in a different way, or maybe served us in the past and aren't helping us now, and we could actually work with them in some way. And I do feel there's that tendency in this form of spiritual practice to see some parts as bad.
Mm-hmm.
And for me anyway, I guess there was a time in my own practice life where I felt like it was a matter of ratio. Like, if I could spend 5% of my waking life as the universal ocean of being, that's fine. And 95% of the time, I can still be Jay, the grasper. Yeah, my Hebrew name is Moshe Yaakov. Yaakov, the grasping and holding on. And that's fine. And yet, I found even in that, and that was kind of a joke. I didn't really try to, I didn't count out my hours and fill it in on the spreadsheet, but I feel like I want even more, like I don't think Dan is a schmuck. Like I want to find a way that affirms this capacity of the mind to be aware of itself. And maybe it's not the mind. Maybe it's awareness to become aware of itself. Maybe it's capital A, awareness to become aware of itself. And maybe that's what, maybe in some way we might be moving to that might save the universe, or at least this planet. I want that, and I want a sort of tantric affirmation of the smallness as well.
The embodied experience, the experience of the personality. Yes, I don't feel like I am at risk of losing that.
Well, I'm at risk. I'm personally at risk of denigrating that. That's my number one. I am self-judgmental. I'm self-lacerating. I'm self-flagellating. I've done a bunch of practice for 30 years. I've come to peace with some peace with that tendency, because I see that part as having tried to protect me and trying to do that. So I guess for me, I recoil any time, and I was in the closet for 10 years, so I learned a lot about self-hatred. So I'm always wary. Like, I feel like that's why I struggle with Yom Kippur every year, and like I could do without tshuva completely and just do it a different way, and maybe we should just get rid of tshuva. So that's all. I want to stand up for all those parts of ourselves that might be in the shadow.
Yeah, first of all, I also am a fan of IFS, one of the ways that I spoke about this in the book was the ego is court jester, and the court jester is the most fun character in the court. I mean, that's kind of where the little nudges happen. That's where things get moved along. That's where you're able to kind of get perspective and say, whoa, just a second. And so all of that is at play. So I am with you on, yes, there's a tendency to denigrate. Yes, I think I fell into that in some places in the book, though I was trying to do it for a purpose. and that ego isn't bad. Ego doesn't need to be destroyed. It needs to be fun. It needs to kind of have its role and dance its dance and play its play. And that's part of the drama and the fun of living in this life.
That's the perfect transition to Q&A.
Perfect.
Because everybody gets to ask from whatever part of themselves they'd like to.
Please identify if you're speaking from your large mind or your small mind before you ask your question.
Right.
So first of all, I hesitate to interrupt this discussion because it's just really, I'm very much enjoying the back and forth. I do want to open up for questions, and maybe I'll start, but know that you could be next.
Can I do one quick thing before the Q&A?
Yeah.
I always forget about Goshmias, about materiality. So so Dan's books are for sale outside those doors, and to accommodate Shabbat, you'll find a personally handwritten index card in every one of those books with ways to send payment at whatever time after Shabbat, if that's your practice. A couple of mine are out there too, also with little notes in there. So for folks who need to get home for whatever reason, make sure to support your visiting author. And hey, you could support me too, but mostly support Dan. Okay.
Thanks.
I always forget to do that when it's my book event. So
I'm glad that you remembered. I definitely would have done that, but you're wise to do it sooner rather than later. I'm wondering, I really appreciate the tension that both of you have been bringing out in terms of the experience of having a wide, open, connected awareness and then floating back to the ego. And I have in my mind in particular, I very much the experience sometime of noticing a moment when I want to call forth my wider sense of connection, which is also for me at least often a more patient self. And trying to bring that forward. And in many places, it works really well. So like often if I'm in this building, I'm pretty good at doing that. Like I put on my rabbi hat and I can do that pretty well. But if I'm at home, I'll be like, oh yeah, I'm going to put on my like wide open awareness and it'll be there. And then like snap, I'll be right back into my ego. And I'm just wondering if, you know, Dan, I'm going to ask you, but either of you could really answer this question. You know, if there's a part of your daily practice or part of what you bring to those moments where maybe your wide self, your big self, your larger self, your connected self is able to actually sort of assert itself, maybe even at the request of your ego, like, I know I'm needed now, and what that looks like, and any challenges you've experienced in trying to do that.
Yeah, for me, it tends to be just noticing that as soon as I notice that I'm acting from a small place and I'm acting in kind of a yucky small way, not to denigrate, but if I'm acting in a kind of a yucky small way, becoming quicker and quicker to notice that, and almost like feels almost like wrong in my body, and I'll feel it viscerally. It's like, ooh, like what's going on? It just doesn't, something feels off. And then, you know, for me, like the calling forth is really just remembering, oh, that wider awareness is here. And just by reminding myself, oh, that's here, I say, oh, and that helps kind of quiet the small and help the large to show up. I want to come back to something that you said, which I appreciated, which was a Jewish articulation of the direct path that you found in this book. And that was another thing that I was trying to do in the book, was write something that would talk about awakening and enlightenment that wouldn't piss Jews off. Because I frequently find that in Jewish circles, people will speak those kinds of words and they will say, you know, like the Buddha or like Jesus. And Jews are kind of like, how am I to access that? And so I don't think of this as a Jewish book. I'm hoping that it would be a book that somebody who was not Jewish from any background would be able to get something from and appreciate. But I also wanted to speak to a Jewish audience about these topics in a way that would not run into the same resistance.
Thank you. Enjoying this a lot. So it sounds almost like the smaller state, if you will, the ego state, is not, and not to bring this back to Judaism, but is like anxiety. And what you're saying is, like, when I notice I'm anxious and I'm aware of me in this, because that's the anxious part, and I'm able to say, oh, the world, you know, this is a much bigger expansive place, and that sort of, if I'm understanding correctly, sort of calms you into being part of the bigger self. I mean, am I oversimplifying? Am I putting too much emphasis on anxiety in this?
Here's how I'll respond. Things show up for different people. Anxiety shows up. Depression shows up. These things show up for people. And I would say it is frequently like the move in the spiritual circles to say, well, you know, if you meditate, then you will be happier. And you'll manage your anxiety and you'll manage your depression, and all those are gonna kind of go away, and you'll just be happy, happy, happy. And for me, it's more like, when there's anxiety or when there's depression, it is contained in that something larger. And does that make it easier for me to manage the anxiety and depression? It does. It does. But the goal isn't, this is a path to manage anxiety and depression and all those, you know, yucky feelings, because I hate those yucky feelings. I'm going to make all those yucky feelings go away. Like, the more you try and push away the yucky feelings, the worst results you're going to get. And if instead it's something like, oh, this feels anxiety. This is, anxiety is present. This is an interesting experience, anxiety. How does that feel? How does that feel in my body? How do I respond when I'm anxious? What is that like? And having the anxiety or the depression be contained in something larger rather than managed. This is a strategy to manage.
If I could piggyback a tiny bit, you know, the Tibetan, there's a Tibetan practice of small moments many times, because, you know, what we now understand in Western science is neuroplasticity. Our settings of anxious to calm or happy to unhappy, these aren't factory settings that are unalterable. They're kind of all skills, they're malleable. And so as you, if one word that I teach a lot in my own work is just the word and. So anxiety is present and there's a radiant awareness that's aware of the anxiety. That doesn't necessarily mean the anxiety is not going to go away by any means. And just like you said, the more you try to make it go away, the less it does. But what I found is that small moments many times, if I do that 100 times a day, then eventually the mind becomes more, it becomes more fluid, and it becomes easier to step back or swim upstream a little bit. And then it does, then if so, if it works 1% of the time to notice the radiant awareness containing anxiety and self-loathing or whatever, then in a few months, it might be 2% of the time it actually works, and it sort of dissipates on its own. And over a couple of years, it might be 10 or 20% of the time. That, but you can't, it's not, again, it's not like that's the purpose and I'm doing this in order to dissolve the thing, but that sometimes I find the and works really well. Sometimes it really doesn't. And when it doesn't work well, it's a time for self-forgiveness. It's like radiant, pure awareness is aware of this shit, and here it is, and it's still there. And okay, I'm gonna try to love that as well. But I do find like the and gets easier and easier. You know, that Kabbalistic, or the Hasidic practice, Hasidic Kabbalistic practice, of kind of making it easier and easier to kind of zip to Ein Sof, zip to the infinite, which maybe is underneath that Hasidic teaching that the guy goes to learn how, from the Rebbe, not some secret Torah, but how he ties his shoes. That there can be this interpenetration of expanded consciousness and the everyday.
And if there's not that interpenetration, then you just keep at it. Like, there's more work to be done.
Right, and there's, right, yeah.
Let me start. I am at ground zero with all of this, but I'm hearing ego in a negative, in a pejorative sense, and I'm wondering where agency comes in. I think agency in the service, I see an interplay between one's consciousness of oneself as part of a larger whole and the agency that is required to make the world a better place because one is part of that place. And I don't see, I mean, you know, it may not be the Freudian model, there may be another model. But I see agency as very positive and God, you know, Kaplanian. So I don't see agency, the positive sense of agency in what you're talking about.
So two things. The first is, ego is not negative. So I think we've said that a few times, and I understand why it still is coming through as negative. Because usually what we've got is, and not in the Freudian sense, but this this ego. And if we're going to try and talk about something else, another possibility, a different way of life, then somehow we have to say, okay, there's something else and something other. Ego is contained within it. Ego doesn't, it's not bad, doesn't go away, but it's not the whole thing. And if ego is where it's at, if ego is the only thing, the most important thing, then you can't get to talking about other possibilities. And so that does sometimes sound as, all right, let's like leave this ego thing over here, and you know, and it can sound kind of negative about ego. That is unintended. And then agency. This was really interesting for me. So as I was going through, I would say, you know, my changes, I really lost motivation. And that was something that doesn't happen with everybody or for everybody, but it happened with me. And a lot of that was that my prior motivations were very much about, you know, how can I make, you know, imagine, you know, a blade of grass saying like, how can I be the most special blade of grass in the lawn? And after like being able to see that I'm this blade of grass trying to be the special blade of grass in the lawn, I just said, oh, that's so stupid. Like, you know, and then the motivation to do that, you know, which was, I want to leave a legacy. I want to, you know, do important work. Yes, because there's important work to be done, but also because, you know, I feel like a strong sense of self, and I feel self-satisfied, and I feel like I'm worth something when I, you know, do those great things. And what has happened to me over time is that the motivation is different. Motivation came back, but it came back different. It didn't come back in the same way. And so in the book, the way that I address this is I say that, you know, the passenger, the driver is now the passenger. What used to be the driver is now the passenger. But the car still goes. Like, stuff is still moving, it still happens. I can't predict in the same way where it's going to go. I couldn't have predicted that I was gonna write this book, that I would be talking to you here tonight. I could not have predicted that not long ago. And yet, here it is. And so, it's not that there is no agency, it's that, at least for me, that sense of agency is more along the lines of, you know, the surfer riding the wave. I'm not directing where the wave is going. I'm just trying to stay on the board and see where the wave takes me. But I'm riding the wave. Like, it's still moving, and it still takes something from me to stay on top of that board.
So we're probably going to take one, maybe squeeze in two more questions. So I saw Ben, you want to say?
That was a great answer. I'm thinking about that now. I forgot my question completely. Wait, I had kind of an elaborate question, sorry. Number one is asking a question and all I realized is an act of ego. I thought, what an incredible talk this is. I want to ask some questions or say something. I realized when I came across as like the intelligent person asking a great question. Is that just a bad idea to do that in the first place? If we're actually separate, trying to impress people with my question is probably not the right idea. But something kind of perhaps related to that, perhaps it isn't at all, is that if I'm by myself or walking somewhere among strangers or out in a forest or something, I can feel the sense of being part of everything and the ego kind of floating away a little bit pretty readily. I feel the sense of expansiveness. When talking to people or a person, it's not that way. Either it's very easy and I'm just talking with the person, but I'm obviously me, they're obviously them, or I'm kind of negotiating the moments with this person, thinking, what will they respond? How should I be? The feeling of togetherness there is more or less absent. So how do you deal with that?
Yeah, that was my experience for a long time. Like I would, you know, be able to be on my own and to access this other sense of what this life is that is living through me. And then I would, you know, open my eyes and talk to people and boom, you know, I was taken out of it. And I would say that's still a challenge. Like, it's easier for me if I say, you know, I'm gonna have some alone time so that I can feel that okay, you know, that's much easier for me. But over time, what I was able to do was to be able to bring at least more of that that sense of presence, even when I was interacting with people, even when my ego would be triggered in the ways that you just beautifully, I think, said. You know, you're going to say some words to people, and, you know, is that going to call attention to myself? And, you know, all of that, like, where is this question coming from? That in those situations, and I think you did a beautiful job of showing some self-awareness of that, and I, for me at least, that was the beginning of where I was able to say, all right, what would it mean to bring that and talk to people? How do I stay in touch? In the book, a technique that I suggest is bringing my attention into my body. That for me was very helpful. So, you know, you can all do this now. Rub your hands together like this. Okay, take your hands apart. Now feel the energy in your hands. And now place your hands in your lap. You feel the energy in your hands in your lap? Still there? You don't? It's okay. But for some people, there's some nods. There's energy in your feet, too. A little harder to feel. Try and feel the energy in your feet. Okay, so now I'm feeling the energy in my hands and in my feet, and yet I'm still talking to you. So part of my energy is in my body, and that's helping kind of keep me connected in a way, even while I'm talking to you. And by doing that kind of a practice, I would say pretty regularly when I'm talking to people, or if when I'm talking to people, I notice that I'm getting sort of pulled out and pulled away, it's a reminder and helps settle it a little bit. And that's been helpful for me to kind of take that alone time to being able to be with people as well.
I feel like I just need to mention Martin Buber also in that interruption in the unitive can also be seen as a positive because it's the other person who's interrupting that. And that's a form of revelation also, right? Here's this other person who I can't totalize, that's philosophical language. I can't say I know everything about this person. I've figured out all their facts. I know who they are. I can never say that. It's always this revelation of the other that, and you know, Buber was responding against unitive thinking and non-duality. And so I and thou is his way of bringing back what we might call ethics, that it's good that's interrupted in a way, and to be truly present with another person in that way, in the I-thou way that Buber describes, calls forth a different flavor of this spiritual consciousness, one that is maybe a little more receptive and listening, and anyway, it's worth exploring.
So, this is great. I hesitate to bring it to an end, but I also hesitate to make anybody drive home very late at night. I'm going to ask you two questions. You only have to answer one. but you know, the question that I'd been on my mind is just noticing the beginner's part of this and the awareness that we have a lot of, you know, very experienced beginners in the room, or, you know, or very inexperienced beginners. And maybe it was what you just offered, but I was wondering, like, if you were going to say, like, here's the beginning, here's just step one, if you want, what is step one? And if you don't feel like answering that question, the other question is anything you want to say.
I don't have a prescribed step one. I think that different people at different moments will find that different steps are the right step for them. I don't know. Do you have a step one?
Yeah, come up with the last thing to say so that I'm not the one who says the last thing. Okay, so just don't pay any attention. Just do your own, think about the profound ending. If you have a basic meditation practice or prayer practice, so you're doing your thing, you're doing your vibe, you're doing the thing, turn the attention to the part of you that knows or notices or witnesses the experience that's happening. So I'm in a prayer service, I'm singing, that's great. I can be in that experience, that's lovely, that's great. Not, you know. I can also just sort of inquire that there's also the knowing of that experience. There's also this awareness of the experience. It's easier maybe in meditation, but also in prayer. But in meditation, I'm knowing with the breath, there's this and this. I can just turn the attention to it's becoming aware of awareness.
one more word. I would say this is, again, this is counter what most spiritual teachers would say, but you don't have to do this. Like, it is totally fine if you wanna like live and feel like I'm a separate person and having my separate life and you've got that drama and you're having a good time with it and go for it. Like there's absolute, that's totally fine. My sense of that larger awareness is not that it's sort of sitting back and saying, damn, like you won't listen to me. You know, it's kind of, I'm, you know, it's comfortable with you like doing your thing and spinning your wheels and like, if it's working for you, go for it. Like, fine, it's like, it's okay. And if, on the other hand, you're feeling like, you know, I'm kind of interested in exploring other aspects of what it means to be alive, what this life is, then I would say, all right, try and follow that. Like, what? Get really curious about it. Where's that coming from? What is that? What's that sense? What's that yearning? And I would say deep curiosity for me. I don't know that it's for everybody, like that's the thing to do. But for me, that was really helpful, is cultivating that kind of deep curiosity.
Oh, I wanted to say thank you very much to both of you. This has been a really, I think, powerful and profound discussion. And you've both done a really terrific job at trying to articulate something that is usually described as beyond articulation. So I appreciate your poking at it and brushing towards it and trying to bring us along with you. I want to, just because we can't forget the gosh mute, remind everybody that there are books from both of these great fine thinkers present, and they have entrusted you to just take them. And that at a later time, the part of you that is pays attention to things like money, to then like look at the instructions and pay them for them. They're in the back. And part of me that wants to remind you of a few things like that is just, this is the beginning of what is actually a really full Shabbat. So tomorrow we're going to be studying Toba Spitzer's book, God is Here, and thinking about the metaphor of water, which is actually a nice place to go from some of the kinds of comments that we've heard tonight. We're having a Kaplan Minyan tomorrow morning, which for those of you who don't know what that means we're having just like a little bit of a condensed service and having a, so that we can have a longer talk. And that talk is going to be from a woman whose name, her first name is Claire, I'm forgetting her last name, but she's going to be speaking about issues related to indigenous rights in the United States. And then on Sunday evening, our community is part of a transgender day of remembrance. So I just want to make sure those things are on your map. And with that, I want to say thank you so much. Thank you for being here. And thank you for being here. And feel free to hang out and continue to visit and continue to talk. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.